Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. So today, inshaAllah ta'ala, we will be starting our series of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. We're still continuing on the series of the Sahaba. And the same disclaimers that I gave with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu an, we'll also give with Umar ibn al-Khattab. And that is that this is not in any way meant to be a detailed biography of the Sahaba. The level of detail I went into in the Seerah, I'm not going to repeat with the Sahaba. And we're just going to go over briefly the life and times of each of the Sahaba that we're going to choose. And also, this is not a detailed analysis of their Khilafah. So when we do Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, radiallahu anhum, we're just going to go over an overview, the main points of their Khilafah. Otherwise, the fact of the matter is, for most Muslims, it does get a little bit tedious, frankly, even boring, to go over all of the details of the Khilafah and the politics and what decisions they made and whatnot. That's something that, for the history students, is interesting. For us as average Muslims, we just want to have bits and pieces and just to know our basic history in a roundabout manner. So inshallah ta'ala, we're going to spend maybe 2-3 weeks on Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu an, and then move on to Uthman and Ali radiallahu anhum, and so on and so forth. So Umar ibn al-Khattab, today we begin with the basics, his background, his family life, and his story of Islam. Umar ibn al-Khattab is the son of, obviously, al-Khattab ibn Nufail ibn Abdul Uzza ibn Riyah ibn Abdullah ibn Qurat ibn Razah ibn Adi ibn Ka'b ibn Lu'ay ibn Ghalib. The main point is, he meets with the Prophet ﷺ at Ka'b ibn Lu'ay. And that is 8 generations. Ka'b ibn Lu'ay is 8 generations. So Umar radiallahu an meets with the Prophet ﷺ after 8 generations. And therefore, amongst the 4 Khulafa', he is the one who has the farthest distance in genealogy. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu has 6. Uthman has basically 3 or 4, depending on the brothers, if you want to go back to. And of course, Ali ibn Abi Talib is, of course, the grandson of Abdul Muttalib. So he's a cousin of the Prophet ﷺ. So amongst the 4, Umar ibn Khattab belongs to the Banu Adi. And the Banu Adi goes back 8 generations, if you like, to merging with the Prophet ﷺ. So the clan that Umar ibn Khattab belongs to, the sub-clan, is the Banu Adi. And the Banu Adi was not of the top clans of the Quraysh. It's not like the Umayyah, it's not like the Banu Umayyah, it's not like the Banu Abd Manaf, it's not like the Banu Hashim. It's one of the lesser known ones. And their most famous person before the coming of Islam, their most famous person from that tribe was Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail. And Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail is, who is he? You can remind me, who is Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail? Who is Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail? The what? Okay, and move on. You're in the right direction. What is the main point about Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail that everybody should know? No. That's way back. That's... Exactly. Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail was one of the 4 Hunafa before the coming of Islam. He was of the 4 people who rejected idolatry. And he is the most famous of them. He is the most famous of them. Another one is Waraqa ibn Nawfal. So Zayd and Waraqa and a group of them, they rejected idolatry. And Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail is a first cousin of Umar ibn al-Khattab ibn Nufail. Okay, so Nufail, the grandfather, has 2 sons. Well, he has many sons. Those 2 sons are Khattab and Amr. And Khattab and Amr have Umar and Zayd. So Umar and Zayd are first cousins. But there is a huge age gap between them. Maybe even 40, 50 years age gap. Okay, so Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail is far older than Umar ibn al-Khattab. And he dies before the coming of Islam. So Umar is a young man when Islam comes, as we're going to come to. And his very older cousin, Zayd, already passes away before the coming of Islam. So Zayd ibn Amr, by the way, so he is the first cousin of Umar ibn Khattab. And he is also the most famous of those Hunafa who rejected idolatry. And refused to worship other than Allah, and the Prophet ﷺ met him as a young man, and he asked him, what is the matter between you and your people? And Zayd said, I refuse to worship these idols, I will follow the religion of Ibrahim. So this is Zayd ibn Amr, this is the older cousin of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Umar ibn al-Khattab was born, we don't know exactly when, one early book says 13 years after the hijrah. And this seems to make sense, as this is the dominant opinion, that he was younger than the Prophet by 13 years. So he's younger than Abu Bakr by 11 years. Okay? So he's 13 years younger than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the descriptions that are given in the books of history is that he was a light-skinned man with a reddish tone on his skin color. And he had deep eyes and large hands and feet, and he was taller than the average member of the Quraysh. And of course, everybody knows this about Umar, he had a strong muscular build. So his body is automatically, you know, there are people that are very muscular and strong. Umar ibn al-Khattab was like this since his youth. And his beard as well was a large full beard, and he usually dyed it with henna. So generally it was a reddish tinge because he would always put henna on it. And it is also mentioned that he had a large mustache as well, and that he would twirl the mustache as men do when they're thinking of something. So he would be twirling that mustache, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. His grandfather Nufail, Umar ibn al-Khattab ibn Nufail, Umar ibn al-Khattab ibn Nufail, his grandfather Nufail was of the leaders of the Quraysh of his time, of Nufail's time. And he had a part of the Darun Nadwa and the inner circles of the Quraysh. However, his father does not seem to have played any prominent role whatsoever. We hardly have any mention of Al-Khattab, Umar ibn al-Khattab. We have hardly any mention of Al-Khattab. And the only thing that we know about him, and we're going to come to this riwayah, is that he was a very harsh man, a very bitter or a crude man, and harsh to his own family. That's the only thing we know. And most likely he even died before the coming of Islam, because he's never mentioned at all after the coming of Islam. So in all likelihood, he seems to have already gone away from the scene before the coming of Islam, because he is not mentioned at all as an enemy or as a friend or anything. His name is simply not found. So the only logical assumption would be that he is no longer around when Islam comes. Umar's mother was by the name of Hantama, and she was from the Qurayshi sub-clan of the Banu Makhzum. And who is the most famous person of the Banu Makhzum who can remind us? The Banu Makhzum? Very good. Khalid ibn Walid. Who else? No, that's the Banu Makhzum. No, Banu Makhzum is not the Umayyad dynasty. Banu Umayyad is somebody else. Khalid ibn Walid and, you should know, Abu Jahl, exactly. See, I knew you knew. Right? No, he's... Abu Jahl is from the Banu Makhzum. Okay? So, Umar's mother was a first cousin of Abu Jahl. So, Abu Jahl and Umar are related blood-wise. Okay? So Abu Jahl's first cousin is Umar's mother. And so Abu Jahl and Umar have a blood relationship between them through the mother's side. As is typical, we know very little about the childhood of Umar ibn al-Khattab. As is typical, we understand, and who's going to remember this these stories and whatnot. What we do know is that he was one of the very, very few people who learned how to read and write in the days of Jahiliyyah. It is said that when Islam came, barely a dozen or maximum 15 to 20 people knew how to read and write in Mecca, because there was no need to read and write in that society. Umar ibn Khattab is one of those who knew how to read and write before the coming of Islam. And this demonstrates that Umar ibn Khattab was into education, into intellectual sciences. Otherwise, there's no need to learn reading and writing in that society. In the whole city, you have a dozen people who know how to read and write. Umar ibn Khattab is one of those people. And like most young men at the time, he grew up working as a shepherd. He grew up working as a shepherd. That was his first occupation, and it was the occupation of most young men when they are growing up in that society. And we learn this because of a number of things that he himself said later on in his life. Again, who's going to record the story of Umar? What he himself said, this is what we know about him. So it is narrated that one of the years when he was the Khalifa, when he went for Hajj as the Khalifa,
and he passed by a particular valley on the way to Mecca. He passed by a particular valley. And he paused when he saw this valley. And he remarked, La ilaha illallah al-aliyy al-azim. How magnificent, yani, or how great is the one who gives what he wishes to whomever he wishes. I remember in this valley, I used to come. Now he's the Khalifa now of the world that is now conquering the Sassanid Empire, conquering the Byzantine Empire. Now he is yani Umar ibn al-Khattab, Khalifa to Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he sees this valley and he says, La ilaha illallah. This was the same valley where as a young man, I would be a shepherd to the camels of al-Khattab, his father, and my uncles and aunts from the Banu Makhzum. So he would be a shepherd for his own father's flock and for the animals of the Banu Makhzum, his uncles and aunts of the Banu Makhzum. And I used to feed them in this very valley. And Al-Khattab, so he's reminiscing now, and this is the only thing we know about Al-Khattab, this line is the only thing we know. And Al-Khattab was a very harsh and brutal man. He would rebuke me even if I worked hard. And if I didn't, he would beat me. That's the only phrase we know of Al-Khattab. Okay, that he was extremely harsh with, even with his family and his children. And Umar radiallahu anhu remarked, and at times I would spend the whole night alone over here with no one other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, you can imagine as the Khalifa, he goes into the valley and all of a sudden all these memories come back of 50 years ago when he was a young man. And now where is he now as the Khalifa? So he goes back and he goes, there were times I would spend the whole night alone. Nobody in this whole valley other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with me. Everybody is gone, I'm all by myself. And now look at where I am and the position that I have. So this shows us that Umar radiallahu anhu began his career as a shepherd, which was the common thing of the time. And it is also mentioned in the books of history that once in his khilafah, he called the people to the masjid and he stood on the minbar and he gave a short khutbah. And in it he said, O people, I remember clearly the days in which I used to take the camels of my uncles and aunts from the Banu Makhzum. And all I would get in return for all of that labor was a handful of barley or dried dates. And how difficult those days were. So the whole day, or to be honest, more than a whole day, because when you're shepherding camels, it's not a few hours. You will go for 2-3 days and then you will come back. So he would go and come back and all he would get is a handful of barley or a handful of dried dates, and that was a difficult life. When he came off of the minbar, Abdurrahman ibn Auf said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, what was the point of that khutbah? When all you did was you put yourself down. Where was the point? Why did you call the people and you gave a khutbah to put yourself down? So he said, I felt something stir in my heart. And a thought came to me, O Umar, who is better than you? And so I wanted to put myself in my place. That I gave the khutbah to tell the people who I am, so that they don't think this waswasa. Shaitan came and put, shaitan comes and does waswas to all of us. So shaitan put waswasa. And Umar thought to himself, who is better than you? So they said, I need to put myself down in my place. So he called the people who goes, I was the shepherd. I used to be and of course, being a shepherd is a very, very humble thing. It's not something that you boast or brag about. It's putting himself down, that I used to be a shepherd and I would work and I would just get a handful of barley or dates as my recompense or remuneration. That was my salary, to get a handful of dates. And this difficulty and also the father's harshness perhaps also explains a little bit about Umar's own characteristic, radiallahu anhu. Yet, as we shall see, he was known for being very strict and harsh. He was known, and Islam needed that strictness for its place. But underneath was a core of softness and mercy. And we will see this, inshallah ta'ala, today and throughout the next few lessons as well. Eventually, he moved on from being a shepherd. It is narrated that he would regularly attend the Suq al-Ukkav. And what is the Suq al-Ukkav? Who can remind me? What is the Ukkav Suq? It's the poetry. When did it take place? No, not in front of the Kaaba. In Mina. In Mina. It would take place in the Hajj season. The most famous poets would be their poetry is posted on the Kaaba. Yes, but the Ukaz takes place after the days of Mina, after the days of Hajj. It takes place, and the poets would come, and there would be these gatherings. So the fact that Umar radiallahu anhu is attending those gatherings is a demonstration that he is basically getting an education, because that's the education of the time. That is the only education of the time, to be a part of that gathering and listen to the poetry and participate. So Umar al-Khattab began attending those gatherings. Eventually, he became a caravan manager. And he would take rihlat al-shita'i wa-sayf to Syria and to Yemen. And this earned him some wealth. So over the course of the next few years, he becomes a regular caravan person, and he learns the tricks of the trade, and he becomes a businessman. And therefore, this earned him a good amount of wealth. Not enough to make him what we would call rich or wealthy, but enough to be what we would call basically middle class. So he worked hard out of sheer poverty, and Allah blessed him even before Islam to basically become something of a middle class, basically wealth-wise. So he was not very rich, like eventually Abdurrahman al-Awf or Uthman became very rich. He was not of that ever. But neither was he extremely poor, as some of the Sahaba were. Ibn Mas'ud and others were very poor. Rather, he was of those who was middle class. And he worked his way up from being extremely impoverished into something of this nobility. And eventually, because of his efforts and because of his character, the Quraysh appointed him to be something of an ambassador, a safir, an ambassador. And he began involved in representing the Quraysh in other tribal treaties. So he was chosen to basically, and the books mention a number of, not relevant to our class, but he was sent on a number of disputes to represent Quraysh and to hack out an agreement with another tribe, to negotiate terms with another tribe. And of course, all of this, Allah is preparing him for what? For political leadership. Allah is preparing him to become the Khalifa. Why did the Quraysh choose him? It's obvious. He was not going to budge. He was going to preserve the rights of the Quraysh. He wasn't going to compromise easily. He has the character that is needed in an ambassador, that he's not going to give away the rights of the Quraysh, and he will get as much as the Quraysh needed. And this also shows us one thing about Umar ibn al-Khattab, which was very known in him, his loyalty to whatever cause he was with. He was a very sincere, a very loyal person. And this loyalty, this sincerity, this faithfulness, this is why he was initially opposed to Islam and the Muslims. Because he's loyal to his people. Not because he was loving of the gods. So his opposition to Islam was not theological. It was cultural. And there's a big difference. Umar ibn al-Khattab was not of those who was passionate about the gods. Rather, the reason why Umar radiallahu anhu was persecuting the Muslims was because he felt the Muslims are breaking away from his society, from the Quraysh and from the ways of his ancestors. That was why he tortured and he did what he did. And in fact, even before, it is mentioned in Ibn Ishaq that his father Al-Khattab would be very harsh with Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail, who is Umar's cousin, right? His father Al-Khattab would be very harsh with his own nephew, because Zayd is his nephew, his brother's son. And he would rebuke him and be very angry at him for having left the ways of his forefathers. And this is, Zayd never became a Muslim per se, because Islam never came in his time. By the way, we talked about Zayd, and we said Zayd, inshallah, the Prophet himself, he said he will be in Jannah on his own, meaning his own ummah. Nobody will be with Zayd as an ummah, because he's his own ummah. He didn't believe in the Prophet because it's before his time, but he rejected everything else. So Zayd is in Jannah representing his own ummah, right? So this is, Zayd is the cousin of Umar ibn al-Khattab. So Umar's father was harsh with Zayd and rebuked him, and perhaps even more than just rebuke. The books basically say he was extremely harsh with his nephew. So this kind of trickled down to Umar as well, that Umar ibn al-Khattab felt the Muslims are leaving the way of my forefathers, and therefore he was extremely anti-Islam because it was breaking the ranks of his society. It is also mentioned, and he himself mentions this, that as a young man, he was into wine and bad company. This way he himself mentions this, that I would go and drink with the other youth of the time and bad company. And this is the reality of most young people illa man rahima rabbuk, that the reality is at that age, unfortunately, the riffraff and the hormones and everything, it all kicks in. And it's not a justification, it's the reality that most young people find it very difficult to be even righteous according to their own standards. And Umar al-Khattab himself, he radiallahu anhu, he mentioned this, that I would be of those who would be in the company of that group of people and drinking and whatnot. And nonetheless, this is in the days of Jahiliyyah, and Allah Azza wa Jal has forgiven all of that. Another story narrated about him, and this is a very important story to bring up. It is an infamous story, and all of us have heard this story, and that is the story of him having buried his daughter alive in the days of Jahiliyyah. And we've all heard this story, and the story goes as follows, in case you haven't heard it. The story goes as follows, that Umar ibn al-Khattab would narrate in detail the story that his wife gave birth, and she hid it from him for a while because she knew the temperament of Umar. And then one day it was discovered, and the baby was playing with him and playing with his beard and everything, and he very, very cruelly, the details are there, they threw her in the pit and he buried her and everything. Now this story is mentioned and all of us narrate it, but the fact of the matter is, it is not found in any classical book of biographies of history. It is not found in any book written in the original era of Islam or the first 500-600 years. We don't find this story at all. And it does seem to be a complete fabrication, to be honest. And one needs to realize Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu is despised by a group of Muslims, and the non-Sunni Muslims. They do not like him at all. And it is not too far-fetched that these types of stories are put into circulation by people who do not like Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. The fact of the matter is that this story appears to be a complete fabrication for many reasons. Most importantly, number one, it is not mentioned with any isnad, not even a fabricated isnad, in any classical biography or work of early Islamic history. It's not mentioned in al-Tabari, in Ibn Kathir, in al-Zahabi. It's not mentioned in Ustul-Ghami. Basically, all of the biographical dictionaries of the Sahaba that are well known, you can go look them up. They don't have this story. It does not have it. And in fact, this story, it is actually made popular by modern people. So for example, the Arabs here know of this person, Abbas Mahmud al-Aqad, the famous, I didn't mention his nationality, you're the one who wants to bring it in. the famous writer, poet, yani self-professed faylasuf, I mean, he's just a rajul adib, yani a person of adab. He's not an alim. Nobody considers him an alim. And frankly, he has shi'r that is also a bit bizarre and weird. He's just, when did he die? 1960 or something. He died last generation. He just wrote a number of books. This is perhaps the source where the story becomes popular. Now, who is Al-Aqad to be an authority on Umar ibn al-Khattab's biography? Obviously, nothing. You go back to the authoritative books, it's not mentioned. So this is the main point. Another point is that the tribe, and the reason I go into detail is because we need to expel this rumor. And all of you should be aware that this is a lie. It is simply not true that Umar al-Khattab did not, astaghfirullah, kill his own daughter. Even though if he did in the days of Jahiliyyah, he is forgiven. You understand? In the days of Jahiliyyah. But still, it is something that is inhumane. And it's something that is difficult to imagine. Even a kafir who doesn't believe in the Day of Judgment doing this, right? It's something only the worst of the worst do. And Umar ibn al-Khattab is not guilty of it. That's the point. So what is another evidence for this? The fact that his tribe, the Banu Adi, were not known for this practice. Yes, it was found, but it was not the Banu Adi. The Banu Adi were not of those who practice this, and there are plenty of women in this tribe who were well known, including his own sister Fatima and many others of the women of the Banu Adi are alive, yani from that era. Nobody's killing them, okay? And his firstborn, another evidence that this lie has to be a lie, his firstborn child is none other than Hafsa. And Hafsa was born pre-Islam, at least 5 years before Islam. Hafsa is born before Islam. So, why is Hafsa alive? In fact, his kunya is Abu Hafs. So Umar radiallahu anhu's kunya is Abu Hafs. There is no Hafs. He didn't have a Hafs. But because generally the kunya was for the male, and Hafsa was born and she's female, so the name is converted to a male, and he becomes Abu Hafs. His kunya is Abu Hafs. So he's proud that he's Abu Hafs. Yet Hafsa is alive and she's a girl, pre-Islam, which shows what? He's not going around killing his own daughters. Okay? This is perhaps the most obvious evidence that the story simply cannot be true. And then there is a final evidence, and it is a hadith narrated in At-Tabarani's Mu'jam al-Kabir. And I brought it myself to you so that you can just read it directly. It is hadith on volume 18, page 337, where it is mentioned by An-Nu'man ibn Bashir that I heard Umar ibn al-Khattab asked about the ayah, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ. Somebody asked Umar ibn al-Khattab about the ayah, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ. You all know the ayah, right? When the one who is the baby girl that is killed is asked. Umar al-Khattab responded, Qais ibn Asim came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said, I killed 8 of my own daughters in Jahiliyyah. Umar is narrating that Qais ibn Asim said to the Prophet ﷺ, I killed 8 daughters in Jahiliyyah, what do I do? So the Prophet ﷺ said, free for every one of those 8 a slave. So he said, I don't have slaves, but I have camels. So the Prophet ﷺ said, okay, find a badana, which is a type of female camel that is very pricey. Find a badana and free 8 badanas, one for each. Now, this hadith tells us that Umar radiallahu anh is narrating that another person did this to his own daughters. This indicates he didn't do it, or else he would have himself narrated a story about himself. It also indicates that if he had done anything, he would have had to also give the badana or the kafara, and he didn't do that. So all of these evidences put together clearly indicate that the story of Umar ibn al-Khattab murdering his own daughter is simply false. It never happened, and it needs to be erased from our literature and our vernacular. Unfortunately, people, they keep on quoting this, and it is simply not true. And wallahi, if you think about it, it's just not possible to imagine a person of dignity doing this to his own daughter. It's simply not possible. And so to accuse Umar of doing this, radiallahu anhu, and especially the vivid detail, by the way, and this is why a number of our modern scholars have said this is a fabrication from the other group. Because the vivid detail that she was clinging to me, and you know, she's crying as I put her in. I mean, really, you know, I mean, such like a melodramatic, you know, scene out of a vicious, you know, this is not, you see what I'm saying here? It's not something that even makes sense that a man would even tell all of you these details and you know, life goes on. It doesn't work that way. You cannot do this, you know. That's what I'm saying, that he was playing with my beard and cleaning the beard. All of this is mentioned. Yani غرائب وعجائب. It doesn't make any sense, really. Right? It goes against human intellect, reason. It goes against common sense. Wallahi, you don't even need all of these other things. But put together, and I go into detail because unfortunately it is too common to hear this story. And it is simply not true. Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anh might have done things in his youth of drinking wine and whatnot, which is what everybody did. But he did not murder his own daughter. And that's something that needs to be eliminated from our literature. Was there a question or what? So the next point as well. So this is really all that we know about his early life. In terms of marriage and family, so Umar al-Khattab, we have references of him marrying at least 7 women throughout the course of his life. At least 7 women throughout the course of his life. Of course, 3 or 4 of them were divorced in the days of Jahiliyyah, as was common. And again, this was the culture of marriage, divorce, marriage, divorce. No woman remained single. Whenever she was divorced, somebody else would marry her. So Umar ibn al-Khattab married at least 7 women. And he probably even had one or two concubines as well. And from his first wife, he had his two most famous children, and that is Hafsa and Abdullah ibn Umar. Okay, from his first wife. So Hafsa is his firstborn. And Abdullah ibn Umar, the famous Ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, is the full brother of Hafsa, from the same mother. And we're not going to go over all seven women, we're not going to go over all the children, don't worry. That's simply two, it's all mentioned in the books of history. But his last wife that he married was Umm Kulthum bint Ali ibn Abi Talib. Umm Kulthum bint Ali ibn Abi Talib. And this was the last wife that he married. And the story goes that he proposed to the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Now he's the Khalifa, Abu Bakr has passed away. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's daughter, the younger sister of Aisha and Asma. Okay, so remember we talked about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So he had the youngest daughter. He proposed to this youngest daughter. And he was the Khalifa. And she refused. So I'm not going to marry Umar. Aisha, her older sister, says, you're going to turn down Amir al-Mu'mineen. You're going to turn down Amir al-Mu'mineen. And she said, yes, he lives a too frugal lifestyle. Think about it. Men and women all the time, the same issues. Huh? She is saying his lifestyle is below my standards. And she is the daughter of Abu Bakr. It's human nature, nothing wrong. A woman wants a comfortable lifestyle. And she goes, I don't want to live that lifestyle. Okay? And maybe as well. So whatever, she felt she doesn't want to live that lifestyle. So he obviously is not very happy at this. So one of his friends says, okay, I'll give you someone better than her. I'll tell you somebody better than her. Umm Kulthum bint Ali. Because she will connect you with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Umm Kulthum is of course the daughter of Fatima. She is the full... So, of course, Hassan and Hussein are the only two sons, but realize that they had daughters as well. Right? They had daughters as well. They had Zainab. So Zainab is the daughter, and Zainab is the granddaughter of the Prophet ﷺ. Okay? Zainab is the daughter, and Zainab is the granddaughter. So their eldest daughter is Zainab, and they have Umm Kulthum as well. So Umar ibn al-Khattab proposed for this Umm Kulthum. And Ali radiallahu anhu was hesitant because he felt she is too young. He felt she is too young. And Umar said, send her to me, let me see if we can work it out or whatnot, let's see. And he felt that she is old enough. And so Ali then agreed, after they both talked, Ali then agreed and said, okay, she is your wife then. So Umm Kulthum became the wife of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and they had children together as well. And this, yarhamukumullah, and this is a huge, how should we phrase this, destruction of the myth that is propagated by the other group, that Umar radiallahu anhu and Ali radiallahu anhu had some tensions between them. They are father-in-law, son-in-law. The marriage of Umm Kulthum to Umar radiallahu anhu produces children. And so there are children that have Umar ibn al-Khattab's blood and Ali's blood. How can you say that there was any animosity and hatred between them? This is nonsensical from our perspective. In any case, so this was his final wife that he married, Umm Kulthum. And what is interesting to note, his point for marrying her was to have a connection with the Ahlul Bayt. How can he be anti-Ahlul Bayt when he wants to marry from the Ahlul Bayt? Because it's an honor for him to marry from the family of the Prophet ﷺ, right? So again, the whole narrative that the other side presents simply does not fit into history. Ali radiallahu anhu gave his daughter Umm Kulthum. Yes, he was hesitant, but not because it was Umar, because he felt she's too young. And when they both agreed, they said, okay, khalas, then it's fine with me. So Umar ibn al-Khattab therefore married Umm Kulthum, and she was the last of his wives. She was the last of his wives. Now, there's also mentioned a number of narrations are found in the books of history that Umar in fact remarked that he, let's just say, so there are some explicit remarks here that he's not interested in women, and he's not interested in marriage except for one reason, children. So he's saying that I'm not interested in that act at all. It doesn't at all interest me, but I want to have children. And in fact, he said in one of the narrations, the narrator from me goes, I don't have any desire for women were it not for children. And were it not for having children, I wouldn't mind if I never saw another woman in my life. Okay? So his reason for marrying was not the reason that some of us always crack jokes about getting married over and over again without pointing fingers at, where's our other guy here? We're not gonna find him. Okay. Where's the main guy here? Not gonna say anything. Okay. So that's not the reason. He's saying the only reason for me is I want to have lots of kids. And mashallah, he had lots of kids. We know at least 13 children that he had. At least, and most likely more than this number. Okay, so he wanted to have lots of children, and mashallah, Allah blessed him with a lot of children. As I said, the books of history mention 13 names. And we're not going to go over all of them, don't worry. But the two ones you should definitely know, Hafsa and Abdullah. These two play the most important role in the seerah. Others have very minor roles, others are not even mentioned in all the seerah, but Hafsa and Abdullah, radiallahu anhum, of course Hafsa, she's our mother, right? And then Abdullah ibn Umar has so much role in the seerah. He did so many things. He's one of the Abadila, he's one of the Zuhad, he's one of the famous Sahaba, one of the biggest narrators of hadith. So this is Abdullah ibn Umar. Ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. As for his embracing of Islam, what we know is that his brother and sister embraced Islam before him. His older brother, Zayd ibn al-Khattab, embraced Islam before him. We don't have any details about when and how Zayd embraced Islam. But Zayd embraced Islam before him. And he's Umar's older brother. And he was the leader of the family. So Umar could not really do anything to Zayd, because Zayd is senior to him, and he's now in charge of Al-Khattab's family, because he's the senior brother. Umar could not do anything to him. But his sister Fatima was younger than him, and he did not know of Fatima's Islam, and we'll get to her story right now. Basically, that's the famous conversion story. That's his sister Fatima. So Islam has entered his household before Umar embraced it, by both his brother and his sister. And as for his conversion story, we have a number of accounts. We have a number of accounts, a number of different accounts, and we don't know, should we make one story out of all of these accounts, or is one of them right, the others wrong? It appears that the actual conversion took place in the sixth year of the da'wah. The sixth year of the da'wah, which means the third year after Islam went public. So 3 years private, 3 years public. So the third year after Islam goes public, which means that his persecution against the Muslims is lasting for basically 2.5 years. Okay, so his persecution was not very long, but 2.5 years. As well, by the way, it is not narrated that Umar radiallahu anhu ever killed any Muslim, unlike Abu Jahl or others, right? Umar ibn al-Khattab never, like his anger never went to the point of killing another convert. Yes, he was angry. Yes, he might have beaten physically one or two in a fight or whatever, but he did not get to the level of torturing and killing. And that's a big difference with Umayyah, with Abu Jahl, with others. You all know the stories of Umayyah. That's a whole different category. Umar's harshness was more terrifying in his looks and his mannerisms than his actual doing. So as they say, his bark is louder than his bite. Like, he was harsh in his demeanor, but in actual fact, we don't find that he's going around beating the Muslims, that he's going around. Now we see in the story of his conversion of his sister, anger overtakes him and he strikes her, right? Then what happens? He feels guilty and calms down. This is Umar ibn Khattab. That the anger goes quick, but then he's not the type to continue torturing until somebody dies. So it is not narrated that Umar radiallahu anhu harmed somebody to the point of like permanently damaging or whatnot. Yes, he got into scuffles. Yes, he was harsh before converting to Islam against the Muslims, and the Muslims were terrified of him. But it is not narrated that he actually harmed a Muslim to the point of to the point of execution or killing. So he accepts Islam in the sixth year of the da'wah, in the month of Dhul Hijjah, when he is around 30 years old. His actual date is not known. We don't know exactly when he was born. Some say, as I said, 13 years after. So one report says he was 27 years old when he converted. But this doesn't make sense if you go back and figure out 13 years before the hijrah, or sorry, before the after the incident of the elephant. If you do that mathematics, then it comes out to around 30, 33 years old, 32 years old. And this probably makes more sense. He's in his early 30s. He's in his early 30s when he converts to Islam. And his conversion takes place 3 days after the conversion of Hamza radiallahu anhu. So Hamza and Umar radiallahu anhu's conversion together was a huge boost to the prestige of Islam. Because either one of these two is someone who is well established in the upper echelons of the Quraysh, in the networks, he's connected. He's not one of the people who is a nobody in the hierarchy, like Bilal and Suhaib or whatnot. No, these are people that are from the highest, and they are well known. So Umar is the ambassador, for example. Of course, Hamza is the son of Abdul Muttalib, enough of a prestige. Hamza is the son of Abdul Muttalib, enough of a prestige for him. That's all he needs. And Umar is the ambassador, and he is appointed, and he is... So the fact of the matter, their conversions together was the biggest boost to Islam in early Islam. Their conversion together is the biggest boost in early Islam. And according to one report, Umar ibn al-Khattab converted after 39 people, he was the 40th convert. Now, these numbers need to be taken not precisely as science, but as a generic figure. Roughly 40 men, by the way, because they're counting men right now. So roughly 40 men have converted. Umar is the around 40th man in Mecca to convert. Now, there are certain signs of his conversion before he actually converts. Certain premonitions that are going to take place. And two of them are very clear. The first is his reaction to the emigration to Abyssinia. Now, Umar converted the day after, or a few days after, Amr ibn al-As returned from Abyssinia. Returned from Abyssinia, trying to negotiate what? The return of the Muslims from the king. Okay? Remember the failure? Amr ibn al-As. So, the same week, basically, Amr returns, Umar converts. Okay? Now, therefore, a few months before this, the Sahaba have left. And the first time we notice maybe Umar's heart is changing is at the departure of the Sahaba. And the story is mentioned, I gave it to you back when we talked about this, was it 4 years ago or something? So I'll repeat it again because, of course, the note taker, of course, has it all clearly in the notes. I didn't say anything negative, by the way, huh? So your bet is off. It's positive. I said the note taker has it in his notes. That's a praise. Yes, that's a praise. Okay, alhamdulillah. So in the seerah of Ibn Ishaq, we have an entire chapter, Islam Umar ibn al-Khattab, the chapter of the conversion of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. So Ibn Ishaq, Ibn Hisham ibn Ishaq, has an entire chapter of 6 pages devoted to the story of Umar ibn al-Khattab's conversion. And he has multiple stories. The problem is, none of these stories has a fully authentic isnad. They're all broken chains. That's the reality of the seerah. Most of the seerah is broken chains. Most of the seerah, you go back to the tabi'un, or taba tabi'un, then there's a gap. There's a 50-year, 30-year, 100-year gap. Who narrated it from? So we don't know. So putting together 2 or 3 of these stories, there's no contradiction in it at all. And he mentions, so this is Ibn Ishaq narrating, that Ibn Mas'ud said, Abdullah Ibn Mas'ud said, that we were not able to pray in front of the Kaaba until Umar ibn al-Khattab accepted Islam. We were not able to pray in front of the Kaaba until Umar ibn al-Khattab accepted Islam. When he accepted Islam, he fought with the Quraysh until we were allowed to pray in front of the Kaaba, and we prayed with him. And the Islam of Umar was after the people who had emigrated to Abyssinia had emigrated to Abyssinia. Okay, so this is Ibn Mas'ud narrating way later on that, and Ibn Mas'ud is the 6th convert, remember. Ibn Mas'ud is the 6th convert to Islam. So Ibn Mas'ud is narrating, and Ibn Mas'ud was not a Qurashi. He's a Yemeni. He's a hired worker. He's a manual laborer. He's an indentured servant. He's not a slave, but he's not fully free. He's kind of in the limbo, lower class in the hierarchy of the Arabs. So he is saying, we could not pray in front of the Kaaba. Only one person prayed in front of the Kaaba, and that is the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nobody else prayed. Nobody. Until Umar converted. When Umar converted, then all of us could pray in front of the Kaaba because Umar prayed. So the prayer of Umar opened the door for the rest of us to be able to pray in front of the Kaaba. And Ibn Mas'ud used to say, إِنَّ إِسْلَامَ عُمَرْ كَانَ فَتْحًا وَإِنَّ هِجْرَتَهُ كَانَ نَصْرًا وَإِنَّ إِمَارَتَهُ كَانَتْ رَحْمَةً. That the Islam of Umar was the first victory, and his emigration was the conquest, and his leadership was the mercy for the Ummah. So Islam was a conquest, his Islam was a victory, his hijrah was a conquest, and his ruling over the Ummah was a mercy. And Ibn Ishaq mentions that it is, and he gives his isnad to Umm Abdullah binti Abi Hathma, that she said, when we were packing to go to the land of Abyssinia, and my husband Amir had left the house to arrange the final matters, Umar ibn al-Khattab came until he saw us packing. Now, I mentioned this before many, many times, the concept of leaving your home to go to another home was unheard of in these days. It was an exception that typically meant that you have committed such a big crime that your own people don't want you to live amongst themselves. It is impossible to imagine for us how big of a deal it was that the Quraysh Muslims have to leave the pagan Quraysh. And the embarrassment to the pagan Quraysh. That's why Amr ibn al-As is going to the Negus, hand over our people back. Because it's an embarrassment to the Quraysh that you can't take care of your own. You're letting them leave. You're hurting them so much that they voluntarily leave. It's one thing to force somebody out. They're voluntarily leaving, right? So we are accustomed to moving from house to house, city to city. This is our culture. No that big of a deal. For their time, it was unheard of. And this is the first time a group of Arabs are leaving Arabia to go settle in Abyssinia. Imagine this, first time ever. So she is packing, and she is pretty irritated, as it understood, she has to leave and everything. And Umar ibn al-Khattab comes, and he is upon his shirk. And she herself says, we used to hear from him so much evil and so much harm from Umar ibn al-Khattab. And he said to her, where are you going, O Umm Abdullah? What's up? Where all this packing? And she is very irritated, very angry. You can imagine she's very hurt. She has to leave and whatnot. So her anger comes out at Umar. And she says, Na'am wallah, you are the ones that have forced us out from the land of Allah. You have harmed us and you have irritated us and you have persecuted us until we have no choice other than to go out and see the land of Allah elsewhere. So her anger lashes out at Umar ibn al-Khattab. So he said to her, Sahibakumullah, which was a dua they would make. May Allah be with you. He makes a dua for her. May Allah be with you. And Umm Abdullah says, I saw from him a softness that I had never seen before. In other words, he's moved that she is packing her bags and leaving. And he's making a genuine dua for her, that may Allah be with you. Sahibakumullah. And he turned around. And when my husband came, I told him the whole story and expressed my amazement to him. And my husband said to me, do you think that he is going to accept Islam? Do you think that he's close to Islam? I said, yes, from what she had seen. So he responded, فَلَا يُسْلِمُ الَّذِي رَأَيْتِ حَتَّى يُسْلِمُ حِمَارَ الْخَطَّابِ. This man that you saw will never embrace Islam until the donkeys of his father embrace Islam. Meaning dream on, or we say until pigs fly, until hell freezes over. It's an expression, right? Obviously, that it's not going to happen. because of the attitude that they had that they had become accustomed to. So this story shows us that underneath that veneer of harshness was what? A soft heart. And when he realized how hard he had been, he felt guilty. He felt bad. And this might have been the beginnings of his Islam. There's another story mentioned as well of pre-Islam that seems to indicate that perhaps Umar al-Khattab had some premonition of things that would happen. And this story is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, in Sahih al-Bukhari's Sahih, obviously. And it is, Sahih al-Bukhari has an entire chapter in the blessings of the Sahaba, the Ansar, chapter number 35, Babu Islami Umar ibn al-Khattab. So Imam al-Bukhari has an entire chapter entitled The Islam of Umar ibn al-Khattab. This is in Sahih Bukhari. So from Sahih Bukhari, and he mentions a number of narrations, and by the way, because we're talking about Umar al-Khattab, so I should mention these narrations even though they are not directly relevant to what we're going to get to, but because this is Bukhari, and because we're talking about Umar al-Khattab, we need to know the narrations of Umar ibn al-Khattab in Sahih Bukhari about his conversion. So Imam al-Bukhari mentions with his isnad, Ibn Mas'ud said, مَا زِلْنَا أَعِزَّةً مُنْذُ أَسْلَمَ عُمَرٌ. Ever since Umar accepted Islam, we've always been in a state of izzah. This is Ibn Mas'ud saying that Umar's conversion marked for us the beginning of political izzah. And he mentions another story that Abdullah ibn Umar mentions, that once when I was a child, we were terrified in our houses of torture and persecution. And the people were basically fighting my father until Al-As ibn Wa'il came. Al-As ibn Wa'il is the father of Amr ibn Al-As. Al-As ibn Wa'il was one of the most shrewd leaders and politicians. And the Quran indirectly references a number of conversations with him and the Prophet ﷺ. And he was of those opponents who were kind of in the middle. Like I'd mentioned this many times, that the opponents pre-Islam were categories. You had the worst of the worst. These were Abu Jahl and Umayyah and Abu Lahab. These were the worst of the worst. Vulgar, crude, and generally speaking, none of them were guided to Islam. That category, none of them were guided to Islam. Then you had those that were relatively noble. They didn't stoop to that level. And these were people like Abu Sufyan, for example, right? Suhail ibn Amr, for example. These were people that, by and large, many of them were guided to Islam. Then you had those that were in the middle, and the main reason they didn't accept Islam was because of jahili pride, not because of love of the gods. And examples of this are Khalid ibn al-Walid's father and Amr ibn al-As's father. Okay, these two people represent this middle category of enemies. They never accepted Islam. But they had elements of good and decency in them. But their arrogance was too much that they felt themselves above astaghfirullah, yani the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the people were basically arguing with Umar, and Al-As comes along and says, "What is the matter? What is the matter?" And Umar said, "Your people," meaning his own people, that's the way the Arabs talk, "your people," meaning our people, "have threatened to kill me if I embrace Islam." He had already embraced Islam. "If I embrace Islam, they're threatened to kill me." So Al-As ibn Wa'il said, "They have no authority over you. I will grant you the protection." So Al-As is the nobleman, one of the leaders of the Quraysh. Al-As says, "I will give you my aman. You cannot be harmed because I have now given you my protection." And so Al-As was one of those people who gave Umar ibn al-Khattab protection in early Islam. Now the hadith I wanted to mention is an interesting hadith, and also narrated from Abdullah ibn Umar, that Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar, is saying, "I never heard my father say, 'I think,' except that whatever he thought turned out to be true." So his presumptions are always true. "And one time Umar was sitting when a handsome man walked by. And Umar said, 'Either I am wrong, or this person is still upon the religion of his ancestors, or he was the sorcerer for his people. In other words, this is when he's Khalifa and a Muslim passes by. And Umar radiallahu anhu senses something is wrong with this man. And goes, either this man is actually still a pagan, or the only other explanation, he was a magician or a fortune teller. I should say a fortune teller. So call this man to me. So the man comes and he is asked about the reality. And the man is insulted. And he said, I have never seen how in my life how a Muslim is being accused. You're accusing me of something. And Umar said, I command you to tell me the entire story. So the man said, very well, I used to be their fortune teller in the days of Jahiliyyah. So it came out. Because it's embarrassing now that you're Muslim to tell the people that you're a fortune teller. So Umar somehow knew. And this is the concept of firasa. I talked about it a little bit in the seerah sometimes. Firasa means intuition. Firasa means you have an instinct that something is just beyond what it appears to be. And it is narrated that Umar ibn al-Khattab himself said, this is not a hadith. Some people say hadith is not a hadith. اتَّقُوا فِرَاسَةَ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَإِنَّ فِرَاسَةَ الْمُؤْمِنِ حَقٌّ. This is not a hadith. It is a statement from Umar. Fear the premonition or the intuition of a mu'min, because the intuition of a mu'min always tells you the truth. So Umar has an intuition, this guy is, something is wrong with him. Either he's still a pagan, or he was a fortune teller. And the fortune tellers had connections with the jinns. So it turns out he was a fortune teller. So Umar says to him, tell me, what was the most amazing or the most strange thing your jinni ever said to you in the days of Jahiliyyah? So the fortune teller says that one time when I was in the suq, my jinniya came to me all terrified and said, now the jinn speak in very difficult language. The jinn have a language, whenever they speak in our language, even it's not the same. It's a very harsh and the words they use are different. And so what he says in Arabic sounds very poetic. In English, it's almost untranslatable. أَلَمْ تَرَى الْجِنَّ وَإِبْلَاسَهَا وَيَأْسَهَا مِنْ بَعْدِ إِنْكَاسِهَا وَلُحُوقَهَا بِالْقِلَاسِ وَأَحْلَاسِهَا. Who can translate amongst the Arabs? أَلَمْ تَرَى الْجِنَّ وَإِبْلَاسَهَا وَيَأْسَهَا مِنْ بَعْدِ إِنْكَاسِهَا وَلُحُوقَهَا بِالْقِلَاسِ وَأَحْلَاسِهَا. Anyone? Okay, so the gist of it in one word, the jinn are desperate and scared. That's really what it is, okay? So the jinn are now terrified. And the sorcerer basically saying, so the jinni told me that something different had happened in the world. And this was the most amazing thing in my career as a fortune teller, that the jinni itself was terrified, rather than the other way around. So Umar ibn al-Khattab said, you have spoken the truth. Something happened with me as well in that time frame. The same time frame, something happened with me. This is the story that we need to go. That's what we'll go all of this detail, okay? One time when I was sleeping in front of one of the idols, so he's sleeping in front of the Kaaba, there's the idol, when a man came and slaughtered an animal, a cow or a goat in front of the idol. And the idol shrieked a sound I have never heard in my life. So of course the idol is not shrieking, the jinni is shrieking inside the idol. Okay, the idol doesn't speak, but the jinni inside it speak. I have never heard a more terrifying sound. Shriek. And it shrieked. Who's going to translate this now? Ya jalih amrun najih rajulun fasih. Ya jalih amrun najih rajulun fasih. In other words, so and so who is in front of me, a new matter has come, a new thing has come, an eloquent man has appeared. And the man is saying, La ilaha illa anta. And Umar ibn Khattab is saying, it was only a matter of time. It was only a matter of time before we heard there is a Nabi amongst us after this incident. Okay. Now this hadith is in Bukhari. And the point of the hadith is pretty obvious. And that is that Umar ibn al-Khattab in his pre-Islamic days is saying, you know, I too have an interesting story to tell you, that I heard the idol, and it wasn't the idol, of course, it was the jinni of the idol. The idol say that a new thing has happened, an amazing occurrence has occurred, an eloquent man has come, and he is preaching La ilaha illallah. And he goes, right after this, we began to hear, there is a Nabi sent to us. And that is, of course, the coming of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So these are premonitions, of course, of the acceptance of Islam. As for his actual conversion story, then two stories are narrated about the actual conversion of Umar ibn al-Khattab, and both of them are with broken chains. The first of them is in the first person, and I'll quote you directly from Ibn Ishaq as well, volume 1, page 346. So this is directly from Ibn Hisham, who says, from Ibn Ishaq obviously, that someone narrated to me basically that Islam of Umar was in this manner. So he gives the story of the Islam of Umar, that Umar narrated his Islam, that Umar said that I was very far from Islam, and I was a person who used to drink wine in Jahiliyyah. وَكُنْتُ صَاحِبَ خَمْرٍ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. This is Umar narrating. I used to drink wine in Jahiliyyah, and I would love it and drink it all the time. And I would have a group of men from the Quraysh that I would gather with, because that's what they do, right? The young men, that's what they do. They waste their time and they drink, and they, these days they're smoking their whatever joints or whatever. That's what men do. Unfortunately, most people, they don't have that. So Umar is doing this as well. And we used to do it in the house of so-and-so. He mentions the name. So one evening I left my house and I went to the house of so-and-so, but I couldn't find them there. So I said, let me go to the one who sells the wine, the khammar. I'll go and get it from him. And there was one man in Mecca primarily who was the one who was making the wine and selling it. So I went there and I could not find him either. He was not there in his house, whatever, he was not there. So I said, okay, in this case, let me then go to the Kaaba and do tawaf. Don't ask me why from khammar to tawaf. Yani, this is the ways of jahiliyyah, okay? If I can't do that, okay, it's the middle of the night, let me just go to tawaf from the Kaaba. So he went to the Kaaba to do tawaf, and then he says, I found the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam standing in front of the Kaaba praying. And when he would pray, he would face Ash-Sham, and he would place the Kaaba between himself and Ash-Sham. And he would pray between the Rukn al-Aswad and the Rukn Yamani, because that's the direction of Syria. So he was facing Syria and Sham, which is Bayt al-Maqdis, and also the Kaaba. So I said when I saw him, tonight let me hear what he is actually saying. Let me hear what he's actually saying. So I snuck up very quietly so as not to disturb him. And I came from the other side, from the Hijr side. So he goes the other side of the Kaaba because he doesn't want to walk so that he can see him. So he goes all the way the other side. And he said, I went slowly, فَجَعَلْتُ أَمْشِي رُوَيْدًا. I went walking slowly, فَدَخَلْتُ تَحْتَ ثِيَابِهَا. I entered under the cloth of the Kaaba. Because the Prophet is standing where? Literally, in front. And his tilawa is not going to be in a loud voice. His tilawa will be in a somewhat hushed voice, right? So he entered the ghilaf of the Kaaba. And in those days, the ghilaf was not tied down as it is now. It's just from the top. So he comes underneath and he goes, I kept on going until finally I was in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I heard him reciting, and حَتَّى قُمْتُ فِي قِبْلَتِهِ مُسْتَقْبِلًا, until I was standing in front of him in his qibla. مَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَهُ إِلَّا ثِيَابُ الْكَعْبَةِ. The only thing between me and him was the ghilaf of the Kaaba, right? So this is an interesting first person story. So he said, فَلَمَّا سَمِعْتُ الْقُرْآنَ رَقَّ لَهُ قَلْبِي فَبَكِيتُ وَدَخَلَنِي الْإِسْلَامِ. When I heard the Prophet ﷺ reciting the Qur'an, my heart became soft and I began to cry. And that was the first time I entered Islam, meaning I thought of accepting Islam. That was the first time I entered Islam, and I continued standing there mesmerized until the Prophet ﷺ finished his prayer and turned and left. So Umar ibn al-Khattab is still behind the ghilaf, mesmerized with what he had heard. And the Prophet ﷺ, when he would go home, he would exit from the dar of Ibn Abi Hussein, until he went to Al-Mas'a, then he went to the dar of Abbas. So he's saying the direction of how the Prophet ﷺ went home. And I began to follow him home. I began to follow him home until the Prophet ﷺ heard my footsteps. And he turned around and said, مَا جَاءَ بِكَ يَبْنَ الْخَطَّابِ هَذِهِ السَّاعَةِ. What are you doing at this time, Ibn al-Khattab? What are you doing following me at this time? And notice, wallahi, the bravery of the Prophet ﷺ, never once, yani, is there an actual terror. Like there is such yaqeen, such tawakkul. This is Umar ibn al-Khattab in the middle of the night, turns around, faces him and talks to him point blank. What are you doing following me at this time? And Umar ibn al-Khattab says, this is the other story, right? This is not the famous one. Umar ibn al-Khattab says that, I have come to believe in you and to believe in Allah and to believe in you, O Rasulullah, and to believe in the revelation that Allah has come with. So he praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he put his hand on my chest and made dua for me, and I entered into the house of the Prophet. So this is one version. It is not the version that most of you have heard, but it is also found in Ibn Ishaq and it is in the first person. The other version, which you all know in a lot of detail, so I'm not going to read it for you, it's also found in Ibn Ishaq. They're both in Ibn Ishaq, right? And that version is all known to you. And that is the version of Umar ibn al-Khattab one day becoming so frustrated, especially after the Islam of Hamza. So the Islam of Hamza actually depressed him because he felt his people are being split. Because Hamza now is a Muslim, so he feels this is a cause for basically his ummah splitting up. And so he said, I will go and basically execute the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so I took brandishing my sword and I met Nu'aym ibn Abdullah, who was one of the early converts and he had hidden his Islam. So he said, where are you going, Ya Umar, with this sword? So he said, أُرِيدُ مُحَمَّدًا هَذَا الصَّابِئِ الَّذِي فَرَّقَ أَمْرَ قُرَيْشِ وَسَفَّحَ أَحْلَامَهَا وَعَابَ دِينَهَا وَسَبَّ آلِهَتَهَا. I want this man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who has left his faith and broken the Quraysh and considered its most noble to be foolish. So notice, why is he angry primarily? Eventually he says, and mocks the idols. But what is the main reason he's angry? Breaking my community. Considering its elite to be misguided. This is what is paining me. And so, فَأَقْتُلَهُ, I will kill him. So Nu'aym said, you have fooled yourself, O Umar. Do you really think the Banu Abdi Manaf will leave you alive walking on this earth after you kill their Muhammad? Why don't you go back to your own house and fix your own affairs before you go and meddle in the affairs of the Banu Abdi Manaf? So he said, what do you mean, my affairs? What my affairs? And of course, this is when Nu'aym said, don't you know? Your own brother-in-law and cousin. So his brother-in-law was his cousin. And his cousin was Sa'id ibn Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl. The son of Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl. Right? Sa'id ibn Zayd. And this Sahabi is a Sahabi that unfortunately most of the Muslims are oblivious of and to. And yet he is one of the Ashra Mubashara. He is one of the Ashra Mubashara. And he is the son of Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl. And we just said Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl is a cousin of Umar. Right? So the cousin of Umar, his son, is also a cousin of Umar. And that cousin has married Umar's sister, Fatima. Okay? So Fatima has married Sa'id ibn Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl, and they're all from the Banu Adi. Okay, so he says to him, go take care of your own family, your sister Fatima, and your cousin, and your brother-in-law. They have basically accepted the faith. So go take care of them rather than taking care of the Prophet. Obviously, this Sahabi wanted to save the Prophet, and he realized, he knew that Umar is not going to actually kill his own sister. I need to protect the Prophet. So, as we all know the story, and this is the story directly from Ibn Ishaq, I'm quoting this story. So then, Umar became angry, and he turned the exact opposite direction to go to the house of his sister and his brother-in-law, while Khabbab ibn al-Arat was with them, teaching them the Qur'an with a sahifa. And teaching them Taha. So it's mentioned over Surah Taha. And when they heard the footsteps of Umar, Khabbab went behind a curtain that they had, or inside some of the house, and Fatima took the sahifa and put it under the bed. And when Umar entered the house, he was hearing them reciting something different. So when he entered, he said, "Ma hadhihi al-haymana?" What is this mumbling that I was hearing? What is this recitation that I'm hearing? And Fatima said, "You didn't say and hear anything. You just heard, nothing was going on." And he kept on saying, "Wallahi, I heard something. And somebody told me that you have embraced Islam." And he took hold of Sa'id ibn Zayd and began to manhandle him, began to be harsh with him. So Fatima stood up to get in between him and her husband. And this is when Umar smacked his sister Fatima. And when he did so, that is when she became angry at him and said, "Na'am wallahi qad aslamna wa amanna billahi wa rasooli." Yes, we have. This is why you're here? Then yes, indeed, we have accepted Allah and His Messenger and we have become Muslim. Do as you please unto us. So when he saw the blood on his sister's face, because he had caused her to bleed, when he saw the blood on his sister's face, he became sorry for what he had done. And he calmed down and he said, "Let me see, what is this that you are reading?" So his sister said that, "I am worried to give this to you. What are you going to do with it? Because this is the Mus'haf." So he said, "Don't worry. I swear by the gods," and he unfortunately shouldn't have done that, but he's a pagan. "I swear by the gods, I will return it to you as it is." This also shows us Umar could read and write, because he's one of the few that they can actually do this. So when he swore, they gave him the sahifa. And so when he swore, they said, "Well, you are najis, you have to wash yourself." So Umar took a ghusl, and she then gave the sahifa, and in it he read Taha, and he continued reading this until he said, "Ma ahsana hadha al-kalami wa akramahu." How beautiful is this speech and how noble. And now this is Ibn Ishaq. In another version, in Musnad and others, it is mentioned that, in another version, it is mentioned that when he came across the verse, "Innani anallahu la ilaha illa ana fa'budni wa aqimi salati dhikri." So that's the verse of Surah Taha. He said, "The one who says this deserves that he alone be worshipped." Because it says, "Innani anallahu la ilaha illa ana fa'budni." So the Surah Taha says this. So Umar said, whoever says this in such a beautiful manner, he deserves only he be worshipped. And so that is when he wanted to embrace Islam. And when he said that, "I want to embrace Islam," that was when Khabbab came from behind the curtain and said, "You know, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam yesterday make this dua, that Allahumma ayyid al-Islam bi Abi al-Hakam ibn Hisham aw bi Umar ibn al-Khattab. Oh Allah, help Islam with either Abu Jahl or Umar." And in this hadith is reported in Tirmidhi, by the way, that the Prophet ﷺ said, "Oh Allah, bless Islam or cause Izzah to come to Islam with either Abu Jahl or Umar, whichever one is more beloved to you." And Umar was the one who was more beloved, and so he embraced Islam. And so, and then the story goes on, and you all know it, that he went with the same brandished sword. He went with that to the house of Darul Arqam and knocked on the door, and the Sahabi who opened, who looked through the cracks, he saw Umar with the sword, and he came back terrified, and Hamza was there. And Hamza said, "Let him in. If anything, we will kill him with his own sword if he wants to harm." Because now Hamza is on the side. So Umar al-Khattab comes in, and he embraces Islam, and that was when the Sahaba and the Prophet, they said takbir, and that was when they exited the Darun Nadwa for the first time publicly. And they all went to the Kaaba to offer their salah. This is mentioned in Ibn Ishaq. Okay? They all went to the Kaaba. Yeah, they all, what did I say? Dar al-Arqam. They all went from Dar al-Arqam to the Kaaba to offer salah, and that was the first time that salah was offered in public. So both of these stories are mentioned, and some have tried to reconcile between these two to say that Umar heard the Prophet ﷺ recite one evening, and then very shortly after, Allahu alam. To be honest, I think it's an either-or scenario, because each story is totally unique. And it's, for me, it's difficult to reconcile. Because in each one, he begins angry and he ends as a convert. So, we don't know which of these two is the more authentic one. Both of them have their beautiful and profound messages. And in the end, what is important is that Umar ibn al-Khattab indeed converted. And inshallah, we will continue the story of Umar al-Khattab, inshallah ta'ala, next week. It's already late, inshallah, and we'll take questions next time, inshallah ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.